today comes from the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6. I'll be reading from verses 30 through 34. Mark chapter 6, verses 30 through 34. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all that they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves into a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed, he saw the huge crowd and had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. May God add God's blessing to this reading of the Holy Word. This account is also in the book of Luke. In the book of Luke, it tells us that Jesus had sent them out two by two. And they had gone into the countryside sharing the gospel and following the rules and healing the sick. And they came back and said, "Jesus, even the demons flee in your name." And Jesus said, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." And then it said something that sticks with me. It said, then Jesus, filled with joy in the Spirit. Jesus, filled with joy in the Spirit. Jesus rejoiced on this occasion. We think of Jesus as a man of sorrows. We think of Jesus as a man of suffering. But it is so wonderful for me to see in the Word that there was a time that Jesus rejoiced. Some versions say he leapt for joy. He jumped for joy. Jesus was rejoicing to see that the Spirit that he had given to the disciples did not return to him void, and that they had gone out and they were now sharing the Word. And so it's understandable that in our scripture today that the people knew Jesus. They knew because everyone had been teaching them, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent. We are here in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, be healed. In the name of Jesus, demons be gone." Right after this, of course, the people saw Jesus and said, "Well, let's go somewhere that we can be in quiet. Let's go somewhere that we can have some solitude, where you can rest, where you can eat." But the people saw them leaving, saw the boat launching, and guessed where they were going. And so they ran ahead of them on foot, and they were all there when they got there. Now, we know that Jesus had been filled with joy, that Jesus was energized by what had happened. We also know that the disciples needed rest. They had been working hard. Probably Jesus needed rest too. But the Word says that when he got there, it says he felt pity on the people. He felt for the people because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Like sheep without a shepherd. In that day, if you were of a certain manner of cleanliness, if you were of a certain pedigree, if you were a certain kind of person, a certain class of person, you could go into the temple, and your shepherd, so to speak, would be the priest, whoever happened to be serving in that season. They rotated the priesthood, the Levites. That would be your priest. Or if you were a student, a good student, and studied hard and believed like they said believe and acted like they said acted, then maybe you would be a student of one of the Pharisees. And the Pharisee would be your shepherd. But if you were not clean enough to go into the temple, then you were rejected by the priests. And if you were not knowledgeable enough and studious enough to be accepted by the Pharisees, then you were rejected by the Pharisees. And now you were wondering, you love God, you love the Lord, you're looking for a way to get close to God, you're looking for a way to do the right thing, but the religious leaders of your day on both sides of the spectrum have cast you into the street. He saw the crowd and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. The disciples had just gone out and had their grand evangelism. They'd gone into the community two by two, and they had won souls for Christ, and they had won believers for Christ, and now Jesus was trying to find a place to rest, and there was no rest. He would be preaching till night. Just that was the same crowd, this crowd that he said they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. That was the same crowd that saw him split the loaves and fishes, which he would do later that day. As it came into evening, preaching all day long, he split the loaves and fishes and fed the 5,000 with just a few loaves and just a few fish. After that, Jesus went up to the mountain to pray and sent the disciples off to the next dock. And they went out, and the storm was raging, and the boat, they were rowing against the wind and just could not get where they wanted to go. And then they looked up, and there's Jesus walking across the water. Calms the water and walking across. Jesus surely was way energized from being up on the mountaintop praying in communion with God all night. It's a dramatic time in the lives of the apostles, of the disciples, of the movement. This is just after John has been beheaded, and they're starting the movement. Now Jesus can preach with boldness because John is no longer there giving his portion of the message, and it's all on Jesus. Saw the crowd and had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. I know that being close enough to the coast as you are, that you have some experience with hurricanes. In South Florida, I bet I saw more hurricanes than you did. Lots of them. We had two come over in the course of 2 weeks. You open the front door and you see your shingles like a waterfall going into the front yard. It's a scary thing. And you'd pray and pray and pray, and sometimes they'd swoop under you, and sometimes they'd swoop over you. And sometimes they'd go right through your front yard. It's a scary thing. Well, there was one occasion back when I was an associate pastor where the hurricane had come by, and we didn't pay much attention to it because it went a little north of us, and we didn't have to worry about it. Our power never went off. Our streets were fine. Everything was open. Everything was going. And one Sunday morning, a woman came into our church, and she was obviously very tired and very weary, and she introduced herself as a disciples minister from California, and then she started crying because she had been in the hurricane zone. She had been where the hurricane had passed over, just north of us, just 30, 40 miles north of where we were, and told the story of people living under tarps and drinking rainwater and cooking over trash fires and rubbish and told about how desperate the situation was and how many volunteers were there. And she was there helping the people come up with just any way to stay alive, just any way to stay sheltered, just any way to stay afloat until the place could be rebuilt. She talked to me and my senior pastor and told us about this and said, oh, there's a golden opportunity there. This is a golden opportunity there. You can go up there and start preaching the word of Christ, and these people will come and join your church. And we thought, well, that's not right. You know, we always had an excuse. We were good disciples. We weren't going to ask people to join our church. There were plenty of churches up there that they could join. There were other people evangelizing. We would be taking unfair advantage of the hurricane, and we would be basically roping people in when they were in need. And so we said, no, we'll let the churches up there do the recruiting. And she said, well, for goodness sakes, will somebody go bring them in? Somebody needs to round these people up. Somebody needs to teach them the gospel. They're not going to any church. They're not going to the church next door. Somebody needs to go and help them. They're like sheep without a shepherd.
Jesus has used that phrase before. On another occasion. This is in the book of Matthew where it says he had compassion on the crowds. It said they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. But the original Greek said they were fleeced and tossed about. They were like sheep that a thief had come in to get the wool and had shaved them hastily and didn't care that they were hurt and tossed them as much as he had to get them done. And then he left them. Maybe sheared them at a time when it was wrong time of year, and now they would be
cold for the winter instead of shearing them in the springtime. And they were harassed and helpless. They were fleeced and tossed about like sheep without a shepherd. On that occasion, Jesus said, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his field." And we sit here and we pray that the Lord will indeed send workers into this field. Lord, send the missionaries. Lord, send the preachers. Lord, send the persons, whatever. Send those people who have a heart for that. And we never stop and think, well, maybe we are the workers. Maybe we're the workers. Maybe those other people are praying that God will send workers into the field, and maybe that's us. Send workers into the field. The workers are good. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Pray that the Lord of the harvest will send workers into the field. You know, we've all got, just like we had our excuses for not going into the disaster zone, there were plenty of workers there. We knew that help was on the way. There was nothing we could do to help these people, but we forgot about what we were trained to do and what we were taught to do as ministers. We could preach the gospel. We could give the love of God. We could pray with people, and we didn't do it. We made our excuses. Oh, well, there's plenty of churches in Guyton. Somebody else must be already knocking on their doorstep. If they wanted to go to church, they'd already be going to church. Oh, their relatives go to the Baptist church. Their relatives go to the Methodist church. Their relatives go to the Evangelical church. Surely they've already recruited them or tried to recruit them. It's not our place to go recruit these people. We would be taking unfair advantage of them. We would be drawing them in when somebody else should draw them in, and they should belong to some other church. And it wouldn't be right for us to do that, would it? We're not the right church for them. We're too old. We're too small. We don't have enough singles. We don't have enough children. We've got too many children, whatever it happens to be. We will come up with an excuse not to do it. We'll come up with a reason not to share the gospel. We'll come up with a reason not to invite people to Guyton Christian Church. And meanwhile, the people that we're looking at, they would think, well, maybe no, I won't invite them. No, I think that... They're fleeced and tossed about. They're scattered and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And I keep remembering the word of that minister who came in that day and said, well, somebody bring them in. Somebody needs to get them in church somewhere. Why not us? Why not you? Don't just pray that there be workers in the field. Pray to God and say, am I the worker in the field? Am I supposed to be bringing this harvest? Is that my job? Am I the one that Jesus was praying for? Could be. Could be. Jesus talked about this harvest on many occasions. There was the time in the book of John where Jesus had met with the woman at the well. You remember that story? A woman who was like an outcast in the community was at the well, and she could not believe that Jesus actually wanted to talk to her because she was a Samaritan. She couldn't believe he was in Samaria. Jews don't do that. She couldn't believe it. And they had a discussion, and Jesus treated her with respect and treated her as if she knew something. And she said, well, when the Messiah comes, he'll teach us all things. And he said, I'm him. He's here. The one who talks to you. That's me. I am the Messiah. She went and got the people. She became an evangelist, even though she wasn't the right person for the job. She wasn't the right time. She wasn't the right place. She was recruiting the wrong people. Samaritans in Samaria. But she became an evangelist, and they came in her in and ended up saying, well, it's not now because of what you say, it's because we've heard him for ourselves. Meanwhile, the disciples urged him, Rabbi, eat something. They had gone off to find food. But he said to them, I have food that you know nothing about. And the disciples said to each other, could someone have brought him food? My food, Jesus said, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not have a saying, it is still 4 months until the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even now, the one who reaps draws a wage and the harvest of crops for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus the saying, one sows and another reaps, is true. I send you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor. There's two sayings. She says, like the old sayings, like they always say. It's like that cliche that you guys keep coming up with. The first one is, he said, don't you have a saying, it is still 4 months till harvest? What does that mean? Get off the dime and do some work.
It's still 4 months till harvest. You know, they just, oh, it's still 4 months till harvest. We got plenty of time. There's no hurry about this. What's the big deal? We'll put it off till later. That's kind of what the saying must have been at that time. Just let things settle out. Let things happen. Let the crop come in. And Jesus said, look, the fields are white with harvest. The fields are ready to harvest. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Time for the harvest. We have this thing, and Jesus used it as one of his parables as well, saying that the harvest time, the time of harvest, you know, when will the grain be harvested? We're the grain and the sheep, the tares and the wheat. You remember those old stories? What is the harvest? The harvest is always the end of time. The harvest is always judgment day. Oh, there's no hurry. Judgment day has got to be a long way off. Oh, there's no hurry. We're young. We're going to live for a long time. Oh, there's no hurry. Somebody else is going to take care of that. There's no hurry. In 4 months, it'll be harvest, not today. And Jesus said, no, today. Today. The fields are ripe with harvest. The fields are ripe with harvest. Then he's got that other saying. Thus the same one. One sows and another reaps his fruit. I send you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor. The hard work has been done. People have heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. They have heard their relatives talking about it. They have heard other preachers talking about it. They have tuned into Billy Graham on Sunday morning and Joel Osteen. They've heard the word over and over and over, and somebody has scattered those seeds, and they're sitting there about ready to germinate. Well, maybe some of them did germinate. Maybe some of them grew, and maybe it's time for a harvest. And now they need to get with, now that they've got Jesus in their hearts, now they need to get with a church family so that they can grow. You can't be a Christian all by yourself. I'm sorry, that can't last for long, because to be Christian means to reach out and to help other people, to do unto others. You can't do unto others if you're all by yourself. Do unto others as you would have them do to you. You can't do that. We're not made to be by ourselves. When God created Eve, he said it's not right that a man should be alone. That's not what we're made for. We're made for community, and we're made for family. We're made to be together. Well, there are people out there that the seed may have fallen in good soil, and we don't know it because we're not asking. We're not checking into it. They may be ready for harvest, but we're not looking, or we're saying, oh, you know, pray that the Lord will send somebody else, that their Baptist relatives will bring them in, that their Methodist relatives will bring them in. You know, don't ask me to bring them in. Don't ask me to invite them to church. Don't ask me to invite them to bring their kids to the slip and slide Saturday. Don't ask me to ask them about coming to the jam session tonight. Don't expect me to invite them to come to church next Sunday morning. There's other churches out there that already have a church. They used to have a church. Mama's got a church. Brother's got a church. Meanwhile, they're wandering about harassed and fleeced like sheep without a shepherd. Then, you know, maybe we're not shepherds. That's fine. We're sheep. But we have a shepherd. We have a shepherd. Now, I got to thinking back on the several, the last few sermons that I gave. Got to thinking back on them. And I'll just grab the scripture out of the lectionary, and I'll start with the gospel. If that doesn't turn me on, I'll go to the epistle. If that doesn't turn me on, I'll look at the prophet, or I'll look at the psalmist. And in all of these cases, I'll just pick the one that seems to, that sparks my imagination, and just let that go where it wants to go. Let that go where the Spirit leads. But where the Spirit has led us for weeks now is to evangelism. We're disciples. We don't evangelize, do we? No, live and let live. Let everybody else do their own thing. Let them go to their own church. We don't do that, do we? Oh, well, you know, but I've got conservatives in my church and they're not conservative. Oh, but I've got liberals in my church and they're not liberal. Oh, but I've got people that, I've got Calvinists and I've got Arminianists and I've got all these different people in my church, and they're likely to run into the wrong person, and they won't like church. They won't like my church. Meanwhile, there's sheep without a shepherd. Meanwhile, there's sheep without a shepherd. I want you all to please ask somebody to come into this church. Ask somebody if they've heard the gospel. Tell somebody that you might have a unique presentation of the gospel that they would like. Don't excuse yourself from doing that. Don't say, I'm not going to do it because the wrong people are in my church, because this is the wrong person for my church, because they wouldn't like the music in my church. Don't look for an excuse not to.
Ask them in. If they say no, it's fine. It's okay. If they say, no, I've got a church, then you say, hallelujah, and I'm so glad to hear that. If they say, well, you know, I'm just not in the church, say, well, you might want to try this. It might be a little different. Ask them. They're sheep without a shepherd. And it's not necessarily, I know that it's a little bit of a trouble for us. It might be a little bit embarrassing. It might be whatever it happens to be. I don't know why we're not doing it. I don't know why I'm not doing more of it. But we can go out there and ask them. Because the one who is suffering is the sheep without a shepherd. The one who is in trouble, the one who is puzzled, the one who is worried is them. They're the ones who don't have the connection to a church family. They don't have a connection to Jesus that they need to have. It's not that Jesus has cast them aside. It's not even that they have cast Jesus aside. They just don't have a church. I see an entire row empty here. I think we've got room for a few people just right here. I know nobody wants to sit on the front row. It's okay. The elders sit here. Just this row. We've got room for some more people. We've got room for some curiosity seekers. We've got room for some hecklers. Bring them in. I'll work with them. You'll work with them. But in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, let's quit saying, oh, it's 4 months till harvest. Look at the fields. The fields are ripe for harvest. And Jesus told the disciples to pray for workers who had come into the field. And that prayer was answered, and here we are. Let's reach out with love. Let's reach out knowing that we've got something to offer, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ and a church family where people can be loved and forgiven and accepted just like they are. Amen.